Hello, my name is Grant Hamby, and welcome to my channel. Today marks the 125th anniversary of the death of the great Austrian composer Anton Bruckner in 1896. And in this episode, I will discuss and analyze his second mass in E minor. Anton Bruckner was born in Ansfelden, a suburb of Linz in Upper Austria, on September 4, 1824, making him approximately 9 years younger than Richard Wagner and 11 years older than Johannes Brahms, the two composers who exercised a great deal of influence in his life. In 1837, at the age of 13, Bruckner's father died after a long illness. Being one of 9 children, his overwhelmed mother sent him to be a choral scholar at the great monastery at Linz. Bruckner would remain there for 4 years until he went to a teacher's college in Linz in 1841 to prepare for a career in teaching, thus emulating his father. This was a strange choice, as Bruckner had already showed a strong interest in being a musician. After some years of struggle, which included being an assistant to a harsh schoolmaster named Franz Fuchs in the town of Winhag by Freistadt, who generally harassed, bullied, and humiliated the still teenage Bruckner, the situation improved in 1843 when his local prelate took notice of the awful conditions Bruckner suffered. He was transferred to the city of Kronstadt an der Enns as a teaching assistant there. The years 1843 to 1845 were also those in which Bruckner produced his first works with a recognizable artistic voice. The position at Kronstorf also allowed Bruckner to advance his studies in composition. He studied under Leopold von Zanetti at Enns, composing one of his first serious pieces, the Asperges May. He continued to study with Zanetti after his move to Linz in 1845. After Bruckner's return to Linz in 1845, he was also given the appointment of organist at the famous monastery where he had been sent as an orphan. For the next 10 years, Bruckner would study and take numerous exams for various certifications. Bruckner seemed to have a need for some kind of official recognition, and that was a tick that would stay with him for the rest of his life. In 1855, Bruckner began studies with one of the most famous teachers of counterpoint in Austria, Simon Sechter, professor of counterpoint and harmony at the Vienna Conservatory. Sechter was a hard taskmaster. His students were not allowed to work on their own compositional projects while under his tutelage. The workload Sechter expected on his students was enormous and covered all aspects of the art of composition. For the next 5 to 6 years, Bruckner would slave away at counterpoint and theory, and while there is debate about the effects of his study with Sechter, in my opinion, Bruckner's absolute mastery of counterpoint is what enabled him to write such groundbreaking compositions. More importantly, I've always considered Bruckner to be the heir of the symphonic tradition more after Schubert rather than Beethoven, as is commonly held. Sechter is a direct link between the two, as he taught Schubert as well as Bruckner. Bruckner only started composing seriously in about 1861, at the age of 37, making him one of classical music's great latecomers. In 1861, he held the first public performance of his own music, conducting his Ave Maria. He also began studying form and orchestration with Otto Kitzler, a cellist and conductor 10 years Bruckner's junior. Kitzler would also introduce Bruckner to the music of Richard Wagner. By 1866, Bruckner faced a major crisis. He had to decide whether to continue as a cathedral organist and provincial teacher, or to throw himself into composition in the heart of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, Vienna, arguably the musical epicenter of Europe. The stress of the previous decade had taken its toll, and in 1866 he suffered a nervous breakdown. The crisis was precipitated by an obsessive-compulsive disorder known as arithmomania, which is a compulsion to count things. Someone found him compulsively counting the leaves on trees. Bruckner checked himself into a mental hospital in Linz. So bad was his condition that when his sister came to visit him, he had to be physically restrained from attempting to count the number of sequins on her dress. It was immediately prior to his mental breakdown that Bruckner composed the E minor mass, which I will discuss and analyze in this episode. But before we begin, I would like to finish out the high points of Bruckner's career. After his breakdown and rehabilitation at the sanatorium in Linz, Bruckner decided to go to Vienna and seek his fortune as a composer. While it would be nice if I could say that he had a great success in the capital city of the empire he loved, the truth is somewhat different. For many years following his move to Vienna, Bruckner faced extremely harsh critics and an apathetic, if not outright hostile, public. Vienna was deeply conservative musically, and Brahms, a classicist to the core, dominated the scene. There is a paradox here. On one hand, Bruckner himself was deeply conservative, religiously, socially, politically, and so forth. However, musically, he was actually very much a progressive. And I can't but listen to his symphonies and not hear the spirit of composers such as Beethoven, Franz Schubert, or the weight of the classical tradition. Yet at the same time, he showed a marked independence of spirit and a progressive attitude that was more in line with that of Richard Wagner and Franz Liszt. I think the problem is that naive as he was in matters of politics or social reform or religion, he really aligned himself with the progressive movement in music as manifested in Wagner and Liszt. In 1868, he was appointed to his former teacher Schechter's now open position at the conservatory, which he took. After his appointment in Vienna, life would still be difficult artistically. Having become embroiled in the aesthetic wars between the conservatives and the progressives, the result was hostility to his own creative works in conservative Vienna. Bruckner's groundbreaking Third Symphony was written in 1873 and was rehearsed and then roundly rejected by the Vienna Philharmonic. Finally premiered in 1877, the performance was a humiliating disaster for Bruckner. Nearly the entire audience left before the end, followed by members of the orchestra before the music had ended. It was really awful. Several brave souls remained through, including a young and bewitched 17-year-old Gustav Mahler. With the premiere of Bruckner's Fourth Symphony in 1881, his fortunes as a composer began to improve. In 1886, he was decorated by Emperor Franz Joseph with the Order of Franz Joseph, to whom he dedicated his Eighth Symphony. In 1892, he retired from his position at the University of Vienna, where he had been appointed professor of musical composition. Later, Emperor Franz Joseph granted him private apartments at the imperial residence at Upper Belvedere so that the aging composer would not have to climb any stairs. Bruckner died at Belvedere on October 11, 1896. Going back to 1866, the year he composed the Mass in E minor, Bruckner was still stuck in the Austrian hinterland and on the verge of a mental breakdown. Was he to continue as a provincial teacher, organist, and amateur composer, or go to Vienna and attempt to establish himself there as a professional composer? 1866 was a dark year for Bruckner. Over 10 years of study, combined with exhaustion from overwork, along with the stress of teaching subjects he really didn't find much joy in, and also trying to compose music, finally got the better of him, and he suffered a nervous breakdown. And in my opinion, one can detect this tension in the Mass itself. Bruckner wrote a total of 4 Masses, though only 3 are generally considered significant, and all 3 were written in the 1860s. The genesis of the second Mass came from a commission from Franz Josef Rüdiger, the Bishop of Linz, who in 1866 asked Bruckner for a Mass to celebrate the construction of the votive chapel of the new cathedral. Due to delays in construction, the celebration of the dedication did not take place until 1869. The E minor Mass is, in my opinion, the key composition for Bruckner in this period, and his most original and groundbreaking composition prior to his breakdown. Bruckner is Janus-headed in this work. He simultaneously looks forward and backward. There has always been a paradox in Bruckner's life and work. While deeply conservative, religiously, socially, and politically, he was highly progressive artistically. Bruckner's Janus-headed stance is partially explained by his relationship to the Sicilian movement, which was gathering a great deal of steam at the time. The Sicilian movement was a movement in southern Germany and Austria to restore unaccompanied choirs as the foundation for liturgical music. They looked back to the 16th century in particular, prior to the early Baroque revolution in music begun by Monteverdi in Venice. They looked to Palestrina, De Lassus, and other similar composers. From the mid-18th century onward, throughout Europe, masses had become increasingly influenced by opera and other dramatic forms. This included the use of full orchestras, choirs plus soloists, the flowering of bel canto lyricism, and the like.
What Bruckner does in this mass is striking. He takes a serious look back at the late Renaissance. He even quotes Palestrina's Breve Mass in Sanctus. Yet his mass clearly is not merely a sop to the Renaissance style. It's also extraordinarily modern and wouldn't have been out of place even in the early 20th century. Let's start by looking at the orchestration. The Sicilian movement wanted to get rid of all instrumentation save the organ. Bruckner doesn't do that here, but he does severely limit the forces used. The mass is scored for double choir, with no soloist, and winds. The wind forces are very interesting. Two oboes, two clarinets, two bassoons, four French horns, two trumpets, three trombones, and no percussion. This is not really a standard wind band, but more like the wind section of a standard 19th century orchestra, minus the flutes. This leads to my first observation. In terms of orchestration, Bruckner treats the ensemble as a whole as if it were a symphony orchestra. The choir are the strings, insofar as they function like strings. In fact, I would go so far as to say that Bruckner's string writing is an outgrowth of his choral writing. More often, Bruckner's orchestral scoring is compared to the organ, which is fair enough, but incomplete in my mind. I think that's principally true for winds and brass, but his writing for strings has a different source, I think, and I think that is in choral composition. Those familiar with Bruckner's symphonies are well aware of the incredibly rich textures and layers in his string writing. He treats the various sections not as if they were different registers of the organ, but instead as if they were different sections of a choir. Let's take a listen to what I regard as one of the most beautiful sections of string writing in his symphonies. This is from the Fifth Symphony in the first movement at the beginning of the development section. What you heard was string writing of enormous depth and beauty. That's because Bruckner was treating them as if he were writing for human voices. Compare with this section from the Kyrie of the E minor Mass.
Thank you.
The voice leading principles he used with the strings, I think, comes out of his vocal compositions, and the two practices inform one another. So, in the second mass, the relationship of the double choir to the winds and brasses is analogous to the same relationship as if it were in an orchestra. The winds are not merely accompanying the choir. The two groups are best thought of as an integrated whole. One critic has called the E minor mass a sop to the Sicilians, and I couldn't help but think, what? The E minor mass a sop? Either the critic didn't understand the meaning of the word, or the aesthetic value of this mass. It's hardly a sop to the Sicilian movement. It is very much a very fine work of art in and of its own right. I think Bruckner was giving the Sicilian movement a nod, but at the same time, he was clearly saying that one simply can't return to some imagined past. There are usable past, and Palestrini counterpoint is certainly an example of a usable past technique, but one also has to look to the future. Bruckner's orchestration and use of harmony underscores this point. In the E minor mass, we see Bruckner's musically progressive stance and his counter-argument to the Sicilians not simply agreeing with him. At the same time, this mass is also deeply personal for Bruckner. That is immediately clear in the opening Kyrie. This is one of the loneliest pieces of music I know, actually. Let's listen to the beginning. Okay, wow. The second altos intone the tonic E, and the second sopranos come in and a fifth beat above. That opening fifth sounds with a kind of hollowness, an emptiness, as it were. When the first altos come in on G to complete the chord, the effect is not so much a respite from the hollow fifths, but the hollowness is replaced by a feeling of really mournfulness. And then the first sopranos enter with a searing minor second against the fifth of the chord, creating an unbearable tension. This sense of mournfulness continues as the horn answers the women's voices. Bruckner's use of silence is also interesting here, but I'm not going to go into that. The entire chorus then works out a beautifully scored contrapuntal Christe Eleison that leads to an intense climax with the brass. Then the mournful Kyrie returns, except Bruckner develops it to arrive at a new gesture, a cruciform motif in bar 75. That leads to another climax, after which the coda repeats the gesture from bar 92 at rehearsal letter D, and leads to a quiet cadence in E major. The cruciform motif is where the music creates the form of the cross. Basically, we start on a tone, go up a step or a leap, then leap down below the initial tone, and then go back to the original tone by step. It's a visual thing, but it's also clearly audible as well. I don't have much to say about the Gloria, which is in C major, except I do want to note its chromaticism and point out that the delicate and exquisite writing in the Quintola Peccata Mundi section. I would also note the impressive double fugue in the final Amen. Now, the Credo contains some of the most profound liturgical writing since Bach, at least in my opinion, especially the crucifixes. Let's have a listen to that. The scoring of this section is gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous. Bruckner modulates to F minor. The clarinets and bassoons play a gently syncopated motif in their low to mid registers, accompanied by sustained tones in the French horns. This provides the background for the main choral line. The choral line writing is richly textured yet restrained. The chord progression Bruckner employs is beautiful and yet economical. He keeps it simple, but poignant. This is followed by a slight speeding up of the rhythm and tonic imitation between the female and male voices, and a thickening of the texture at the words etiam pro nobis. Then at the word passus, the musical line begins to slow down in a chromatic drop with the winds answering the chorus and a truncated version of the syncopated motif which began the section. The trombones enter for the first time as a bridge to the breathtaking resurrexus, modulating back to F major. The Sanctus and the Benedictus are in some respects a study in contrast. The Sanctus is in two parts. The first, a quiet polyphonic meditation on the word Sanctus, which means holy. It is in G major, with voices alone, quietly and slowly, and built off of two motifs, a rising fourth and a descending third. The texture is rich and polyphonic, imitating Palestrina-style writing, whom Bruckner also quotes. So have a listen to a little bit of that. The texture and intensity of lines increase until the brass enters and the textures become predominantly homophonic on a bright D dominant chord in the key of G major. We're then led in a short space of time through the remote key of F minor, back to F minor again, and then back through to a triumphant G major to finish out the movement. By contrast, the Benedictus begins with a gentle and chromatic romantic motif played by a solo horn and then imitated by the choir. The texture is delicate. There is a constant dialogue between the choir and the winds here. Choral writing itself makes use of a great deal of canonic imitation after rehearsal B, with the winds providing coloristic effects. This intensifies especially after rehearsal D, almost becoming impressionistic, especially after rehearsal E. The figure in the winds is augmented and another layer of texture is added in the low winds from the initial horn motif in imitation with the voices. It's Bruckner's sensitivity to the temporal forces at his disposal that makes this work so compelling, at least to myself. We come at last to the Agnus Dei, perhaps the finest Agnus Dei by any composer since Bach. We are once again in E minor. The upper woodwinds begin with a highly chromatic descending and then rising line, joined it by the choir in unison octaves. The mood returns to the opening Kyrie of the Mass, but the feeling is less hollow. It's more a feeling of pathos, though that is a subjective point of view. The relationship to the opening Kyrie is reinforced when the choir comes in at the words Miserere nobis. There are the same kind of searing dissonances and suspensions. At the final nobis, Bruckner employs a very complex cruciform motif, also found in the opening Kyrie, which I discussed earlier. This figure is repeated, and Bruckner takes us tonally through some adventurous territory, landing on an E minor 7th at the final nobis, which leads to a harsh, very harsh, nearly secundal chord on A, with A as the root, that is, before taking us to a bright A major chord that clouds into the minor mode, serving as a kind of mixed mode plagal cadence to end the mass on a quietly hopeful E major. It's a remarkable ending to a remarkable work. Thank you so much for staying with me to the end. To be honest, I don't feel like I've done this work nearly the justice it rightly deserves, but I hope you were able to get something out of my presentation. Please like and subscribe to my channel. Also, I have a Substack newsletter in which I talk about upcoming projects for the channel, as well as other topics of musical interest. I will provide the link below. Also, I have a Ko-fi account. If you would like to buy me a coffee, I would very much appreciate it. I'll also provide the link below. I wish you all a very good day, and I'll see you again at the next.